Good morning and welcome to 9th lecture of this course. In the previous two lectures, we saw magnetostatic fields, and in that we saw magnetic vector potential, magnetic scalar potential, magnetic forces and boundary conditions in case of static magnetic fields. We will continue that discussion for one or two more slides now, and then we will go into time varying fields. So now it is appropriate time to just summarize the analogy between electric and magnetic fields or circuits. So here this table shows the corresponding parameters of the two types, which basically are analogous to each other. So conductivity and permeability, electric field intensity and magnetic field intensity, current which is open surface integral J dot ds, flux which is open surface integral B dot ds, right. J, current density, is current upon area, which is sigma E, which is point form of Ohm's law, right, whereas B is flux upon area, which is also equal to mu H. V, in case of electric fields, MMF, in case of magnetic fields, resistance is L by sigma S
or rho L by S,
because rho is 1 upon resistivity is 1 upon conductivity. Here reluctance, note the symbol for reluctance. Reluctance is equal to
L by mu times area.
V is equal to E times L is equal to I into R, whereas here it is MMF is equal to H into L, which is flux into reluctance, right. The KVL for electric fields and the corresponding circuits is summation V around the loop minus summation Ri is equal to 0. Here summation all the MMF sources minus summation over of reluctances into fluxes is equal to 0, right. So this analogy is important for understanding various electromagnetic devices. Now we will go over to magnetic energy. So in this course also we will be dealing with magnetic energy for at least two lectures, if not more, and we will also be talking of co-energy later when we are calculating the forces. So magnetic energy E, this symbol I have purposely drawn it like this to differentiate with respect to this E. So energy magnetic is, we know, all half Li square, and that is also equal to half integral mu H square dV, right, or half integral B square upon mu dV, where V is the volume. In this expression, since this is in, this energy is in joules, it is obvious, and we are taking integral over volume, it is obvious that energy density is B square upon twice mu, is also equal to half mu H square, right, and this is the unit in joules per meter cube. Now here for a linear material wherein B and H characteristic is linear, right, we have what is known as energy here and co-energy given by this triangle. Now let us understand this energy co-energy terms little bit. Later on we will talk more when we see calculation of forces in one of the lectures when we start looking at finite element application to calculation of forces. So energy is given by integral H dB dV, and there are two volume, one is volume integral, other is integration over B, because there is a variable dB here, right. So it is basically when we, so the area of this triangle, right, so this is the triangle, triangular area that we are integrating with respect to B as a variable. So this, the area under this curve will be given by this area, is it not? So that will be in fact H dB, right. And this integrated over the volume. That means this B and H, remember, those are at a point in space. So if you may have a core material and then there are so many points of interest, and at each point you will have B and H. So you have to integrate this integral h dB, and then that value you have to integrate over the whole volume. So there are two integrals involved, right? So now you know why h dB is called as energy and B dH is called as coenergy. Let us understand that. So coenergy, as I said, is integral B dH over H, and then again integrated over volume. So energy, if you see, we all know is energy is integral V I dt, right? Because V into I is power, power into time is energy. So now if I actually express V as N d phi by dt, which is Faraday's law, which in fact we are going to see in the next immediate slide, probably most probably next slide. So N d phi by dt is voltage, and I is H into L by N. HL is MMF divided by number of turns will give you I, right? NI is equal to H into L, and then dt. Now if you actually substitute phi, okay, so just to make consistent writing, I think this should be N psi by dt, because we are calling flux as psi, is it not? So let us make this as
N d psi by dt,
so that we use consistent
N d psi by dt
into HL by N into dt. And psi is B into area, and volume is equal to area into length, right? S stands for area. So now if you substitute these two expressions in this equation, then you will get energy density as
integral H dV.
Because voltage, in case of all these inductions and all that, voltage is always d phi by dt, so it is related to dB by dt. So that dB in the energy density term comes from that d phi or dB term, is it clear? So that has the physical significance, the energy has a physical significance, whereas coenergy is this given by this area, which is the area under the curve, the same curve, straight line in this case, with H as the reference axis, because it is B dH. So that is this area under this curve. And that is called as coenergy. For linear material, energy and coenergy are equal, right? But for non-linear materials,
they are not equal,
right? So we'll see more about this when we see the virtual work approach for force calculations. Now here, hysteresis. Now we are ready to understand little bit more on hysteresis of ferromagnetic materials, which we covered in the previous lecture. So typical hysteresis loop is as given here. So if we now take first quadrant, we all understand that the area of this hysteresis loop gives the what is known as hysteresis loss. So let us understand why this is loss. When we say loss, it is some input and some minus some output that leads to loss. So let us understand here, input to the magnetic circuit, what is given back to the source, and what is the difference, which is dissipated as loss. Now here if you see, when actually in the first quadrant, this should be first quadrant. In the first quadrant, you have this when the excitation is increased and the curve follows like this. So now our expression for energy is integral h dB dV. So when from here to here, the energy that is given to the magnetic circuit will be the area under this whole curve. That means this is that curve, and the area under this whole curve, which is OAPCDO, is it not? Because it is integral h dB with B as the reference axis. So that is the input to the magnetic circuit when the excitation goes from A to P. Now when you reverse the excitation, the curve does not follow the same path, and that is why we have this memory effect or hysteresis effect, and then it follows this. Now, the area that is represented by this P, C, D, P, this small area, right, that is the energy returned back to the source. Why it is energy returned? Because now what is the direction of dB? Well, the sign of dB is negative, is it not? Because we are going from P to D, or you know, we are going from C to D while integrating. So, dB is negative. So, that the sign of the energy, sign of the energy or sign of the power is reversed. So, that means when the power sign is reversed, that means power is flowing back to the source, right. So, that means in this, when the curve is traversed from P to D, the area corresponding to this P, C, D, P, that represents the energy that is returned back to the source. That means in the first quadrant, what is the energy lost? O, A, P, D, O. That is the energy lost, right. And if this is for the first quadrant, you can then do the similar way for the all four quadrants, and areas of all these, you know, four areas will give you the total hysteresis loss. Basically, you know, this lost per cycle for the first quadrant is, as I just explained to you, it is given by, is proportional to OAPDO, and that is in joules. Now, this, when you add all these, you know, four areas corresponding to four quadrants, right, you will get loss area, that is energy loss per cycle, right. That if you multiply by F, right, it is cycles per second. So, so much energy is lost in so many cycles. Suppose it is 50 hertz, so 50 cycles per second, so into 50 by second. So, that means it will be, when you multiply this by F, you will get the hysteresis loss, because this energy into F, cycles per second, energy upon second is power. So, that is why it is the hysteresis loss. So, that is why hysteresis loss is proportional to F, whereas later we will see eddy current loss is proportional to F square. So, now we will see time varying fields, the most important law in electrical and electronics engineering, which makes this whole world move, is Faraday's law, and it basically established coupling between electric and magnetic fields. The law says that for any closed circuit, if the flux linking that is changing with time, then voltage will be induced, and that voltage is called as EMF, electromotive force, and that is given by this famous equation, V EMF is equal to minus double d lambda by dt, where lambda is the flux linkage, that is nothing but n d psi, right. So, lambda is n psi. So, here you get minus d psi by dt as induced voltage. Now, this is, as written here, it is field viewpoint. Why it is field viewpoint? Because of this, you know, Lenz's law. Because Lenz's law says induced current field opposes the cause. So, in that closed circuit, the corresponding current that will be flowing, that will flow in such a way that the flux produced by it will oppose the cause, which is this changing flux, right. So, that induced current field opposes the cause, and that opposition is represented by this minus sign, right. Now, the circuit viewpoint is, you know, in circuit viewpoint we do not consider this minus sign, because in circuit viewpoint we consider induced EMF as just n plus n d psi by dt, and then n psi is nothing but L I, because L is n psi by I, L is flux linkage upon current, right. So, then you know you have n d psi by dt is equal to L d I by dt, and that is, we take it as induced voltage. Now, here this induced voltage is opposing the, you know, source voltage. Now, let us
consider a transformer under no load condition. Induced voltage E1 opposes V1 in the primary circuit, and the primary current depends on the difference between the two voltages.
So, here the induced voltage is opposing the source voltage, right. So, that is why that opposition is inherent in this representation. That is why we do not put minus sign here, okay. Going further, this induced voltage, we also know that it can be expressed as closed circuit integral E dot dl, right? And then by using Stokes' theorem, you can get it as surface integral, open surface integral del cross E dot ds. And then, you know, here this d psi by dt, psi can be represented as integral B dot ds, and we are taking n as number of turns as equal to 1. And then this further we can simplify as minus integral dava V by dava t dot ds with minus sign here. Now, here the derivative with respect to time d by dt is made to act only on B, because we are talking of here stationary circuit. So, ds is not changing with time. So, this in a way this is a transformer EMF, because in case of transformer the flux that flows through the core, that you know everything is stationary there. So, that is a transformer EMF. And then now this, when it is equated to this, you get famous Faraday's law, del cross E is equal to minus dava V by dava t. So, we go further. Now, after seeing transformer EMF, we will now see motional EMF. Motional EMF gets induced when conductors move in a static magnetic field, right. So, for the corresponding force,
mechanical force
due to this induced EMF and corresponding induced electric field intensity is given by this Fm is equal to Q U cross B. U is the velocity, B is the flux density. So, the induced electric field intensity due to the motional EMF or due to the motion is given by Fm by Q, that is nothing but U cross B, just rearranging the equation. Now, induced voltage will be again given by integral Em dot dl, and if it is closed circuit, that is why it is closed line integral for closed circuit. Then you know you substitute in place of Em, you substitute U cross B, and then if U cross B is in direction of dl, then this reduces to simple product BLU, where integral dl will be L, right, and this L will be the length of the total closed circuit, right. Now, let us go further and understand what happens to a conductor placed in static magnetic field in such case, where B is vertically down and conductor is placed there, right. Now, moment it is kept there, you will have you know this B will interact with this current through this equation. So, we know J cross B is equal to force density, right. So, J is in minus A y direction, right, because y is into the paper, whereas J here, J and current is coming out. So, J in minus A y hat direction into cross B, B is in AZ direction, minus AZ direction, because it is vertically down, Z is up, that will give you force density in X direction. Now, this force density will move the conductor in X direction with velocity U. Now, you can see here, earlier we saw how we can visualize this moment in this direction, because moment you have this current, it will have its own field around it, and that on this side the field will get enhanced, on this side field will get reduced. So, it will have some kind of stretching action of the conductor in this X direction, that is why the current would this conductor would move. And remember, this force is really acting on the free charges in the conductor, right, because this force is finally on the Q, right. So, the force is acting on basically free charges which constitute this current I. So, going further, we already had you know derived this expression in I think one of the earlier lectures. So, this J cross B can be further, you know, when you integrate it, you will get total force as B I L. The charges are moving in y direction, minus a y direction, and force is in x direction. So, this force in x direction is not going to change the kinetic energy of those free charges, right, and that is why it is only going to change the direction, but it is not going to impart any kinetic energy. So, if the energy associated with that conductor is not going to change, that means there is not going to be any work done by the magnetic force on the charges. Then the question arises, then who is doing the work of this moving this conductor? Now, let us go further. This conductor, when it starts moving with velocity u, now u cross b as per this formula will induce motional electric field intensity into this conductor. So, now that EM, electric field intensity, induced one, will act in direction to oppose the current by Lenz's law. So, now current is coming out. So, EM direction will be going in. So, that is why EM is shown by cross here. Now, this moment is EM occurs and it opposes the current. If we assume that I is constant, because when we are actually explaining some phenomena by some intuitive explanation, we have to assume something as constant. So, here if we assume I as constant, that means the source which is supplying power to this conductor, if that is going to maintain current constant, then what will happen? Moment is induced, electric field intensity will appear and the corresponding voltage will appear. That voltage will oppose this current flow and it will try to reduce the current. So, this source then has to come into action and it will try to maintain this current constant. In other words, it has to supply the corresponding power V EMF into I, right. Earlier when this V EMF was not there, it was only the I square R loss kind of power that was supplied by the source. But now this will be the additional power due to the induced EMF that has to be supplied by the source. So, V EMF into I is the extra power that will be supplied by the source which is being connected, which is connected to this conductor, and that will maintain current constant. And then now we know this V EMF we had derived here, the induced voltage is B L U. So, we are substituting this B L U here and then this becomes B L U into I, and then rearranging this becomes B I L into U. B I L is nothing but mechanical force which we have already we have seen it before, and U is D by T, distance upon time. D is the distance in this direction divided by time. So, now you can see here this is the F mechanical B I L into distance upon time. So, is work upon time, right. So, this work is really done by the corresponding power source which is supplying the conductor, and that power is nothing but V EMF into I, additional power drawn from the source, and that is numerically equal to the work done, mechanical work done by time in moving this conductor forward in the x direction. So, this explains the work is done in this case by the source which is maintaining the current constant. So, and here of course, it is explained the direction of this induced electric field intensity can be again by given by this u cross b, and I have just explained why it should be in a y direction by using this cross product u cross b. Now, if suppose we want to say that this current is not constant, current is let us not assume that the current is constant, then also it can be proved that basically it is a source that is doing work. How? When suppose because of this induced voltage and the corresponding opposition to the current, what will happen? The current will reduce and the kinetic energy associated with these particles, the free charges in the conductor, that will go down, and that reduction in kinetic energy can be associated or can be equated to the mechanical work done and the corresponding kinetic energy gained by this conductor while moving it forward in the x direction. So, that way also it can be explained if we do not make the assumption that current is constant. But remember, this is all little bit intuitive explanation and some assumptions are involved, and for more detailed discussions and more comprehensive discussions on this topic, you can refer Griffith's book on Introduction to Electrodynamics, 4th edition, and you will find a comprehensive discussion on this whole topic there with many, you know, case studies being explained there. A final point in this which I want to say is this, that here what we sort of understood intuitively is that magnetic forces do not act on or do not do work on free currents. Free current means the currents which are because of moment of free charges, as in this conductor. But if magnetic monopoles were to exist, right, if magnetic monopoles were to exist, if somebody finds in future magnetic monopoles, then the magnetic force can act on those magnetic monopoles, individual magnetic charges, as in case of, you know, electric field acting on charges, electric charges, right. So, that is one. So, magnetic forces can act on monopoles
if they exist and do work on them.
In this, we actually saw a case of closed conductor, that means this conductor was part of a closed circuit. Now, we will see what happens when we have a conductor which is like open circuit, that means this conductor, this is a bar conductor, is not connected to any circuit, closed circuit, and it does not form a closed circuit. So, now here let us assume that the conductor is placed like this and B field is into the paper. It is different than here. Here the B field was like this vertically down. Here the B field is into the paper. And let us assume that you have this you know, conductor moved in x direction and with velocity u. Moment that happens, you have again u cross B, and that u cross B will result into the corresponding induced electric field intensity and the corresponding force in vertically upward direction here. Now, that will what it will do, because there are many free charges here. So, this E field will act on positive charges here, and that positive charges will move vertically up and negative charges will move vertically down. So, you will have charge accumulation at the two ends, and this process will continue till this, you know, the potential difference due to this charge accumulation, which is vertically down, and the corresponding force will balance the corresponding force which is vertically up due to this charge separation on account of this moving conductor. So, this will continue till there is a balance between the two forces. So, here I wanted to bring forth this point, that motional EMF is generally in direction opposite to the corresponding, the motional EMF and the corresponding electric field intensity is in direction opposite to the electric field intensity due to the accumulation of charges. Now, you know, we little bit see more on magnetic vector potential, because this vector potential is quite, you know, most of our course when we are solving magnetic field problems by using FEM, those formulations will be based on A, magnetic vector potential. So, it is, you know, worth spending little bit more time on understanding magnetic vector potential. So, now del cross E is given by minus dabba B by dabba T, Faraday's law in point form. Now, B you can replace as del cross A, right, and then you can rearrange, and then it gives del cross E, del cross E plus dabba A by dabba T is equal to 0, right. Now, we know curl of gradient is always 0, curl of gradient is always 0. So, now this E plus dabba A by dabba T you can express as
gradient of something. We have expressed it as gradient of V.
Now, this choice is not arbitrary. It could have been any other scalar potential, but we have purposely taken V here, because when this reduces to static case, dA by dt will be equal to 0, and then E will be minus dabba, E will be equal to minus del V, and that is consistent with electrostatics, is it not? So, E has to be del V, gradient of V minus gradient of V in case of electrostatics, that is static field. So, that is why we are choosing here E plus dabba A by dabba T as minus del V, okay. And then you can rearrange now this as E is equal to minus del V minus dabba A by dabba T. So, now this is the total sort of definition of E. Yeah, so the question is why we are considering this E plus dabba A by dabba T as minus del V, because this has to be consistent with the electrostatics that we have already covered. In case of electrostatics, you have E is equal to minus del V. So, if when here it is a static case, when then d by dt is 0, d by dt of A is 0 because there is no current flowing. If there is no current, there is no A, is it not? So, this dabba A by dabba T will be 0. So, then this will reduce to E is equal to minus del V, which is consistent with electrostatics. That is why we have chosen it to be like this. So, now here this E is minus del V minus dabba A by dabba T. So, this del V term is the charge, is representing the charge accumulation, right? And this dabba A by dabba T term is representing the induction, right? So, in most of the cases, both what we analyze, we generally analyze either of the two cases. Either we are, for calculating purpose, when we solve some problems, either we are dealing with electrostatics, then we are only considering E is equal to minus gradient of V, or when we are talking of magnetic field analysis, we do not consider charge accumulation, is it not? We are purely considering the currents flowing, induced voltages, forces, losses and all that. So, there we are actually not considering the charge accumulation, right. So, either we are, that is why considering either del V term or minus dabba A by dabba T term whenever we do deal with any practical problem in FE analysis. So, a little bit more on magnetic vector potential, its physical interpretation is, now if you take no charge accumulation case, then del V is equal to 0, right. So, then E reduces to this. Now, actually if you you also know E is equal to F by Q, F is equal to QE. Now, this F, we have already seen that F can be on, this F can be on static charge or moving charge. So, that is why I can definitely, even in time varying case, when Q is moving, I can use this expression, E is equal to F by Q, right. Now, here we know, also know force is basically rate of change of momentum. This is by, in mechanics we have seen this, force is rate of change of momentum. So, that is, you know, force you can express as d by dt of mu, where u is the velocity, right. So, d by dt of mu by q. Now, you basically compare this expression E is equal to minus dabba A by dabba T and this expression E is equal to this, then you can easily now infer that A is nothing but momentum per charge. That is the reason, you know, Maxwell originally called A, magnetic vector potential, as electrokinetic momentum vector, which is the correct definition of A. Unfortunately, what has happened is magnetic vector potential, this term has got established over the last few decades, and you know, but it is not really potential, but it is a vector, and it is electrokinetic momentum vector. And whenever we are considering particle dynamics, whenever, you know, electrons as they are moving with velocity v and u, velocity u, and the electron is having charge E, right, then the total momentum of that electron will be given by mu plus E into A, right. Mu is of course normal momentum because of its motion, and E into A, because this A is momentum per charge into charge E will give you the momentum. So, this is the electrokinetic momentum and this is the momentum due to the motion. So, the total momentum is given by this. Of course, this momentum we are not going to use in this course, but you know, those who are interested in particle dynamics, probably this equation would be required at some point of time. Now, we go next to theory of eddy currents, which is a very important topic while dealing with electrical machines, because we are dealing with induced voltages and induced currents, and then corresponding losses that are occurring, they are important to be estimated, so that the temperature rise within the electromagnetic device under investigation is not exceeding certain limits, right. Now, here we start the discussion with again Maxwell's equation, one of the Maxwell's equation, that is again Faraday's law, del cross E is equal to minus dabba V by dabba T, and then we take curl of both sides, right, and then we, you know, this del cross E, there is a vector identity, curl of any vector is given by gradient of divergence E minus del square of that vector, right. So, so it seems again here we are talking of eddy current, induction and all that, we are talking of conductors, so we will not consider here charge accumulation. So that is why, you know, this divergence E, which is nothing but rho V upon epsilon, I hope you remember divergence D is equal to rho V, so divergence E will be rho V upon epsilon, so that is will be 0 because there is no charge, we are not considering charge accumulation. So then, you know, this expression, this equation reduces to this, right. Now here this J, what we have considered, this J is, we are considering only J induced, which is sigma E. I will tell you the, you know, difference, what are the other current densities possible and how the then the equations get modified little later in this slide itself. So this is, you know, induced current density, which is given by sigma E. So E here represents the induced, you know, voltage, right. It is volts per meter, but it is representing induced voltage, right. So now this, you know, this expression, this equation is a very characteristic equation. Actually, we started with this, you know, Faraday's law, and we arrived at this. If you start with some other equation and we, you know, sort of eliminate other, all other variables except some, say maybe B variable, we will also get the same equation in B or H or D. So this equation is satisfied by all these vectors D, A, you know, H, B and so on, what we encounter in electromagnetics. So this is a characteristic equation, this is also satisfied by A, and this is the equation in A that we will mostly use when we do two dimensional magnetic field calculations in this course, right. So before we go to that, let us you know, understand this equation and its context in or its importance and when to use which terms when we are dealing with either low frequency electromagnetics or high frequency electromagnetics. So if you take the ratio of conduction to displacement current densities, right, so J by dabba D by dabba T, then J is sigma E, and dabba D by dabba T J omega epsilon E, and that the modulus of that is just sigma upon omega epsilon. Sigma is the conductivity, omega is the frequency 2 pi f, and this is the permittivity, right. So now there are two cases, if sigma is much greater than omega epsilon, which is typically, you know, valid for metals being analyzed at low frequency. When I am saying low frequency, I am not talking, you know, like 1 hertz to the hertz, I am talking low means power frequency, that means 50 hertz, 60 hertz or even 1 kilohertz. So these are all low frequencies as compared to, you know, gigahertz, terahertz, those frequencies in high frequency spectrum, right. So here, you know, for metals, whenever we are interested in finding eddy currents induced and all that, typically, you know, the conductivity of metals is high and frequency is not that high, and epsilon is quite low, is it not, because 8.85 to 10 raised to minus 12 is epsilon naught, that makes this epsilon quite small number. So sigma is much greater than this omega epsilon. So then, you know, this, the last term here, third term in this equation almost reduces to 0, because that is representing the displacement current density, is it not, because this epsilon here is coming from this dabba D by dabba T term, is it not. So this term here, dabba D by dabba T term, is responsible for this term, right. So basically, you know, we neglect, when we are talking of, we are analyzing eddy currents, we neglect this third term, and that reduces this equation to what is known as diffusion equation. Del square E minus mu epsilon mu sigma dabba E by dabba T is equal to 0. And as I said, this equation, if we had started with some other, you know, Maxwell's equation, or did some, you know, substitutions, then we would have got del square A minus mu sigma dabba A by dabba T is equal to 0 in terms of magnetic vector potential, right. Now, here if this was in terms of A, then there will not be any, there is no source current here, because this sigma dA by, if suppose this was in A, sigma dA by dt is representing the induced current, is it not? Because we, in the previous slide itself, we saw E is equal to minus dA dabba A by dabba T is representing the induced effects, is it not? The induced effects are represented by dabba A by dabba T, right. So, here if this was, this equation was in terms of A, then this mu sigma dA by dt dabba A by dabba T would represent the induced current, right. And that means there is no source current here. Now, you know, you may wonder, you know, if there is no source, how can eddy current be there? For example, you know, if you are given, if there is some metal piece, and then if you know that there is some time varying excitation on that metal, that may be produced by some source, and that relation you know, and you know that certain distribution of time varying field is there on the conductor surface, then that, and if you are analyzing the eddy currents in that, then you do not require their source current. You, what you are requiring only is the boundary conditions, right, which we have seen this, you know, how boundary conditions can be used to analyze fields, you know, by properly setting up the boundaries. So, same thing is here. In fact, and classical eddy current theory that we are going to see next is, you know, we will make use of this equation only without source current and only the surface boundary conditions. But there could be some cases wherein, you know, that you may have source current as well as induced current. That means, suppose, you know, there is a current flowing in a conductor, in the vicinity of that current, time varying current, you have some, you know, metal plate and eddy currents are induced. So, then you need to analyze both induced current as well as the source current. So, you may want to model the whole thing. Then, you know, you have both induced current and source current to be, you have to represent in the equation. Then, you know, that equation will get modified as del square A minus mu sigma dabba A by dabba T is equal to minus mu J S. Now, we know already, I do not know whether we covered the Poisson's equation, yeah, I think we covered. Poisson's equation in magnetostatics is del square A is equal to minus mu J, is it not? We have seen this earlier, right. So, if there is no time varying field, then del square A, this second term will be 0, and it will be del square A equal to minus mu J, which is vector Poisson's equation, which we have seen earlier, right. But this equation is the more general form, wherein both source current is there and eddy current is there, right. And
this term is representing eddy currents.
So, is this clear? So, this is in presence of source current Js. Another thing to note here is, if you transfer this induced current term on the right hand side, the sign of that will become plus, is it not? So, this will become plus. Now, the sign of source current and induced current, they are opposite, and which should be the case, is it not? Because induced current generally opposes the source current. So, that also is consistent here. The next possibility, the second possibility is sigma is much less than omega epsilon, which is, you know, when we you know, analyze dielectrics, for example, then, you know, we have this case where, you know, second term gets neglected, has to be neglected, and then what we get is wave equation, and this wave equation is the starting point for analysis of, you know, waveguides, antennas, transition lines at high frequencies. So, the high frequency electromagnetics basically starts from this wave equation. Probably stop here, because we will continue this in the next lecture. We will stop at this point, and next lecture we will continue from this point, right. Thank you.